You are not hidden. There's never been a moment you were forgotten. You are not hopeless. Though you have been broken, your innocence stolen, I hear you whisper underneath your breath. I hear your SOS, your SOS. I will send an army to find you in the middle of the darkest night. It's true, I will rescue you. There is no distance that cannot be covered over and over, and you're not defenseless. I'll be your shelter, I'll be your armor. I hear you whisper underneath your breath. Your SOS, your SOS. I will send out an army to find you in the middle of the darkest night. It's true, I will rescue you. And I will never stop marching to reach you in the middle of the hardest fight. It's true, I will rescue you. I hear the whisper underneath your breath. I hear you whisper, you have nothing left. I will send out an army to find you in the middle of the darkest night. It's true, I will rescue you. Oh, I will never stop to reach you in the middle of the hardest fight. It's true, I will rescue you. Oh, I will rescue you.
Such a powerful song, and what a great reminder. You know, God is a God who's passionate in pursuit of his lost sheep. His commitment is to find you, and he'll send out an army to do that if that's what's required. You know, it's sad, I think, that some people have such a broken image of God that they can't imagine anything other than God pouncing on them with both feet when they mess up. They can't imagine anything but condemnation. And yet what we see in Scripture, the heart, the bleeding heart of the New Testament, is a God who is reckless in reclaiming what belongs to him. And so I pray that today that God's going to just meet us in a very special way. We're in a series about addiction. And even if today you might think, well, you know, this is not going to apply to me at all, please understand that what heals the addict heals us all. That what works for them works for us. And whatever the problem is, and I know you got problems, you're human. Whatever the problem is, these principles we're going to be looking at today, they work. So in this series, what we did is we started, you know, just simply dared to ask the question, might we have a problem that's crossing a line into addiction? Last week, we looked at God's love for the addict. And today, we want to look at the healing path. I'm calling this message Anyone Anonymous. If you would, just bow your heads with me. Father, I just pray today that you will just continue what you've already started in this service. You're speaking to hearts, you're speaking to lives, you're speaking to us where we are with exactly what we need. And so God, just continue that work and meet us today around your word. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. So I want to talk to you a little bit about Alcoholics Anonymous. It was started back on June 10th, 1935, so more than 80 years ago now, by a couple of Christian alcoholics, one by the name of Dr. Robert Holbrook Smith, also more commonly referred to as Dr. Bob, and William Griffith Wilson, or the people that they call Bill W. The 12-step program, Alcoholics Anonymous, has been a model for a lot of other treatment programs. There are estimated 120,000 AA groups in over 170 countries that represent 2 million active members. Now, that's just in Alcoholics Anonymous. That doesn't include Narcotics Anonymous. It doesn't include Al-Anon. Doesn't include CODA. Doesn't include Overeaters Anonymous. Doesn't include Sex and Love Addicts Anonymous. Doesn't include Celebrate Recovery, all of which are based on the 12 steps. And if you put all those numbers together, you're talking about millions upon millions who have found healing from addiction through the 12 steps. So I want to talk to you about this healing path. But I want you to understand this is just more than that. These transformational truths we're looking at today really do work for everyone. The 12 steps are really just principles for healthy and abundant living. You're going to recognize the truths in Scripture and everything we're going to look at today. We're going to talk about acknowledging our brokenness. We're going to talk about faith in God, surrendering ourselves to God's will, self-examination, confession, healing, restoration of relationships, prayer, meditation, and sharing the good news. All of those are embodied in the 12 steps. Frederick Buechner is one of my favorite writers. He just has this way of putting things, and he's written about a typical 12-step meeting. I just want you to hear this to kind of set the mood for today. He says, they have no hierarchy. They have no dues or budget. They do not advertise or proselytize. Having no building of their own, they meet wherever they can. Nobody lectures them, and they do not lecture each other. They simply tell their own stories with the candor that anonymity makes possible. They tell where they went wrong and how day by day they're trying to go right. They tell where they find their strength and understanding and hope to keep trying. There's not much more to it than that, and it seems to be enough. Healing happens. Miracles are made. And I don't know if you've ever been to a 12-step meeting or not. You don't have to be an alcoholic or a drug addict to go to a 12-step meeting. I actually enjoy going. I've been to a lot of birthday meetings where friends are celebrating 10 and 15 and 20 years of sobriety and just go to celebrate with my friends what's going on. But every time I'm in a meeting, I just think, wow, you know, this honesty, sharing, this vulnerability, this willingness to serve one another, this is what the church was supposed to be all along. Why can't the church be more like a 12-step meeting? You know, I find something very compelling about what happens. So what I'm going to do today is I'm going to walk you through the 12 steps. I'm going to talk about every one of the 12 steps. We're going to look at it through six lenses, if you will. Fess up, look up, clean up, give up, straighten up, and keep it up. So we're going to examine these 12 steps as a model for healing what's broken in our life, even if it's not an addiction. The principles we're looking at are good for men, women, boys, and girls. Doesn't matter where you are in life. You'll learn and you'll benefit from these steps. So let's begin with fess up. And here is the very first. If you've never heard of the 12 steps before, here's the very first one. I've made it more general. In every addiction program, there's a different phrase or word for problem. But I said we admitted that we were powerless over our problem, that our lives had become unmanageable. So the very first step that anybody needs to do in order to get well from any problem you have in your life is to admit you have a problem. To admit that that problem is something greater than yourself. It's something that you can't fix on your own. So it's about facing broken promises and failed commitments and destroyed relationships and unpaid bills and legal troubles and damage that we do to our bodies. By the way, Jesus said practically the same thing to us. When he lays down the path for the spiritual life, we call this the Beatitudes. This is the path of blessing. This is where the spiritual life begins and the path God is taking us down. The very first step, the very beginning, is this simple phrase. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. The spiritual journey, my walk into the heart of God, begins with a confession of my spiritual poverty. God says the path that he blesses is the one that begins with an acknowledgement that we've made a mess of our life, that we've messed things up, that we are vulnerable, that we have secret places, that we have difficult and painful experiences in our life, and we own that and we confess it. So the 12 steps in Jesus, they both begin at exactly the same place. I don't know if you've ever heard of Johnny Erickson Tata. She was a woman who at the age of 17 dove into a lake, hit a rock. It was a shallow lake. It broke her neck, rendered her quadriplegic. But she's been a prolific painter and writer and Christian speaker. Listen to her talk about this. Little wonder the gospel is only good news to those who consider themselves losers. It's humiliating to be sandblasted to the core, to be told by the Spirit that we're not as wise or winsome or loving or patient as we thought. But when the mask of pride is ripped away, there's something refreshing about knowing yourself at the core, the vulnerability, the transparency, the relief of nothing more to hide. There's something really awesome about coming to Jesus and say, Jesus, I got nothing. I bring nothing to the table. I bring my mess, I bring my brokenness, I bring my sin, and he brings abundant grace and healing into our lives. If you want your life to change, that's the way it begins. Doesn't matter if you're an addict or just a sinner or a combination of both, you have to begin with spiritual poverty. We begin with an admission that we can't handle it on our own. And I'll tell you why this is so important, because this is the biggest lie we tell ourselves. We say, I can handle this all on my own. And the only response I say to that is if you could handle it on your own, you would have handled it long before now. The truth is that we can't handle life on our own. Each and every day, I need for God to do in, through, and for me what I cannot do for myself. Amen? God has to do that for me. So here's a great first step prayer. It's actually from the Psalms. The word the psalmist uses is afflicted, but you can easily substitute the word addicted. Turn to me and be gracious to me, for I am lonely and addicted. The troubles of my heart have multiplied. Free me from my anguish. Look upon my addiction and my distress and take away my sins. So here's step number two in the 12 steps. We came to believe that a power greater than ourselves could restore us to sanity. Again, every day I stand in need for God to do in, through, and for me what I cannot do for myself. So let me just address something right up front. A lot of Christians get twisted up. They read the 12 steps and they see this phrase, a God or a power that's greater than ourselves, our higher power, or God as we understand him. And they say, you know, that's not right. There's only one God in Scripture. And I understand that and I agree with that. But listen, I'm kind of the opposite opinion. I think it was sheer genius on the part of the founders of the 12 steps, who were Christian men, to leave the God question open. The intent was to create a place of openness for people to come and search, while at the same time acknowledging that the key to breaking the power of addiction is spiritual in nature. You got to seek something greater than yourself, because yourself, in yourself, it's not enough. In fact, look at this. In the big book, there's a lot of different ways it refers to God: creator, maker, father, director, principal, one infinite power, great reality, spirit of the universe, supreme being, creative intelligence. You'll find always when it's a reference to God, it's always capitalized. So think of it like this. AA is kind of like you begin at spiritual kindergarten. And the most fundamental building block of life is, who is God? So just to do step two requires a certain level of humility. And that is, I come to step two and I realize that whatever my beliefs about God up to this point in my life, it's not kept me from drugging and drinking. It's not kept me from making a mess of my life. That maybe there's something wrong with the way I see God or the way I relate to God. It requires that kind of humility just to take this step. You know, the fact is this, is that many times when we talk about this higher power, it's an acknowledgement that my thinking about God just might need to change, because it may not be what you know. It may be what you know that ain't so. You know, for 28 years I've been your pastor, and we get a lot of people who are seekers here, and sometimes people come in the door and say, I'm an atheist. I'm not even sure what I'm doing here. And I say, oh, great, you're an atheist. T- tell me about the God you don't believe in, because maybe I don't believe in him either. Now, hear what I'm saying. Because a lot of people think they're atheists because they have all this damage on their God image, and they think this is really what God is like. And they come in here thinking, you know, with all these twisted definitions of God, and they think, well, I don't believe in this God that just guilts and shames and beats you up and all this kind of stuff. And I say, well, I don't either. If that's what makes you an atheist, I guess I am one too, right? We've got to get back to understanding the truth that nobody arrives at the house of God without their pet God under their arm. And this idea that you and I get our God image directly from Scripture is not really true. You know where the God image begins? It begins long before you were talking in words. It begins in the home. It begins with your mom and dad. That's the first seminary. That's where you learn about God. It gets imprinted emotionally on your souls. Now imagine if you were an addict and you grew up in an addict's home. And your parents, because of their addiction, they abandoned you often. You were rejected often. You suffered quite a bit. Your first image of God is that the big people in your life, the people who are supposed to care about you the most, aren't there for you when you need them. And you tend to carry that very broken image of people, and you put that onto God himself. It's not true. It's not right. It's not real. But more than your belief system up here, in your heart, you feel that's true. So what I'm saying is, right up front, the 12 steps acknowledge your problem is spiritual in nature. You need a power that's greater than yourself. And maybe the God you have tethered to your heart does not reflect the God of the universe. But quite possibly, if you would open yourself up to this God of the universe, he could help you and show up in ways that might surprise you. Now, I'm going to talk to you more about this in a few minutes and tell you why the God image becomes clearer as you move through the steps. But let's move on to look up. So in step three, it's this. We made a decision to turn our will and our lives over to the care and direction of God as we understood him. Every action in life is preceded by a decision. We make a decision, and then we follow through with the action. We make good decisions sometimes, bad decisions. Good decisions, we call those successes. Bad decisions, we call those our spouse's fault. No, we call them failures. We call them failures. Step number three says we begin by making a decision to turn our lives and our will over to God. It's really a question of who is going to be God in your life. And this is very fundamental to all of us. Who's in charge? Who calls the shots? There's an interesting story. Dr. Harry Thibault, if you know much about the history of AA, you know that he was a psychiatrist who worked with hundreds of alcoholics in the early days of the program. And he said that egocentricity is a major problem in all of addicts. And he had a name for this egocentricity. He called it His Majesty the Baby. So that every addict has His Majesty the Baby at the center of their life. And His Majesty the Baby wants what it wants, when it wants it, the way it wants it, and I want it right now. Now, we have a grandbaby right now that's 9 months. Everything I just said is true of her. I love her incredibly, but she wants what she wants when she wants it. She wants it right now. And His Majesty the Baby is at the center of all of our lives. Listen to Thibault explain this. His Majesty the Baby does not abdicate his throne readily. Frequently, a sufficient degree of pain is required to expel this tyrannical king from his throne. In other words, His Majesty the Baby does not want to go quietly into that dark night. Instead, it is constantly looking for a way to reassert power and control. It wants the throne. It wants to call the shots. And by the way, that's not just what makes you an addict. That's what makes you a sinner. You know, the Bible says the problem in sin is that we all want our own way. You ever read this verse from Isaiah? We all, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us has turned where? To his own way. I want what I want. When I want it, the way I want it. That's what it means to be a sinner, not just an addict. What is at the center, the core of every human being is His Majesty, the baby. So we want our own way. Now, the big book offers as a part of the prayer for the third step, relieve me of the bondage of self that I might better do thy will. That's a great prayer. It's interesting. The historian for Alcoholics Anonymous entitled his work, Not God, because he said that's the most important hurdle every addict has to overcome, to acknowledge deep in their soul that they are not God, that God is God and they are not. Now, those are the first three steps of the program. So let me tell you something. I've known a lot of people over the years who do what they call the 12-step waltz. You do steps 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, and you don't do anything more than steps 1, 2, 3. They know they need God. They see their lives aren't working. They commit their lives to God over and over again, but nothing is getting better. They're not becoming spiritually whole. What's the problem? Well, the problem is commitment is not enough. It's not. You see, what comes after step 3 in the 12 steps is all the stuff that's intended to root out the drivers of addiction. It's about facing and owning our messes before ourself and God and others. So let's look at cleanup. In step number 4, it says this: we made a searching and fearless moral inventory of our life. This is the scariest step in the 12 steps, at least so far. It's why people get stuck doing steps 1, 2, 3 over and over again. Step 4 is about facing what you've chosen not to face, where you stop running, where you stop medicating, where you stop ignoring or just hoping it'll go away. In the big book, Bill W. says, our lives we should consider like a business, and we should periodically do an inventory of that business to see what's good and to see what's bad, to keep what's good and polish it and display it and get rid and jettison the bad. So the purpose of making an inventory is to get an accurate inventory of who I am. And so there's like 3 modifiers in this step. It says the inventory is supposed to be searching, fearless, and moral. In other words, it needs to be fact-finding, fact-facing, and factual. But why do you do this in writing? Why not just do this in your head? I'll tell you why. Because there's something about writing this out that helps to bring clarity to our spirit. There's the founder of the Navigators, a guy by the name of Dawson Trotman, said this. I've always stuck with me. Thoughts disentangle themselves when they pass through the lips and the fingertips. There's something about talking things out or writing things out that brings clarity in our mind, helps us to sort it out, makes us get really clear about what we're talking about. This is why you write it out. So what do I inventory? Well, 2 things: your problems and your potentials. When it comes to problems, there's 3 things you want to inventory. First, you want to inventory your resentments. Resentments are the things that you put on the back burner. They simmer. It's the things you feel over and over again, but particularly people you don't like, people who've done you wrong, people that you resent, people that you're hoping bad things happen to them, situations you can't let go of, things that were done to you, injustices, injuries, but you just hang on to your heart. You kind of have them there, and you're just hoping that somehow they're going to rectify on their own. Let me tell you something. That's one of the reasons you stay stuck. Nobody can make forward progress and hold hate in their heart. You can't hold on to resentment. You got to make an inventory of that resentment to let it go. A second thing, you want to do an inventory of your fears. Your fears. Why your fears? Because fears block your desires. Every single day, you're making a decision between your desires and fears. What God has placed in your heart versus what you're afraid of doing. And what we do, as long as we're not acknowledging those fears, they reign over our spirit. So you want to acknowledge, these are the fears in my life. These are the things that are blocking my desires, keeping me from becoming what I meant to be. And then third, you want to inventory your harms. So these are the things that you've done to cause pain and suffering to other people. I need to own that. Acknowledge it. This is what I did. In what ways I've caused other people to be harmed. And I'm just not talking about the things you've done or failed to do. I'm talking about the things you've caused. Now, you've heard me say this before. You know, there's 3 kinds of apologies. There's the I'm sorry I was caught, you know, the big crocodile tears, and, you know, they really feel sad in the moment, but they're not really that sad. They're just really sad that they're caught. And then there's I'm sorry I was wrong. And that's another level, and it's better than I'm sorry I was caught. I mean, at least people are acknowledging they did something wrong. But that's not real sorrow. Real sorrow is I'm sorry for what I caused. Think about this. If I cheat on my mate, I can say, hey, you know, I'm sorry I cheated on you. And that's a certain level of damage, but your damage was beyond the cheating. Your damage caused your mate to not trust you anymore. You caused that. You can reject people and cause people to become very isolated. You want to think about, this is what I did, and this is what I caused in that person's life. I caused them to think this certain way, to not feel this certain way. I want to own what I caused, that I didn't sin in a vacuum, that this had a ripple effect through their life, and it caused great damage. When I own that, I'm really owning my harms. But this is not just about doing an inventory of your problems. It's also about your potentials. You know, one of the things I have discovered is that addiction tends to stifle the creativity and the real person inside. There's all kinds of wonderful gifts and abilities that every single person has. But addiction suppresses them, causes them not to develop. I'm always amazed at the number of former addicts who come to me and say, you know, I never knew I could do this, or I never knew I could do that. And it's like they have this kind of new burst of energy and excitement in their life. We inventory our potentials, but then step number five, we admitted to God, to ourselves, and to another human being the exact nature of our wrongs. You know, in the spiritual realm, the way you get rid of something is to confess it. Now, I hear a lot of Christians say, well, you know, I only need to confess to God to be forgiven. And I say, amen, you only need to confess to God to be forgiven. But if you want to be healed, you got to confess to others. The book of James says, confess your faults to one another so that you can be healed. Yeah, you can be forgiven. Just own it all to God. You don't have to go through a priest. You don't have to go through me. God will forgive you completely. But if you want to rejoin the human family, if you want to know what it's like to be real, then you've got to confess it to others. Listen to Dr. Edward Selmer. In some mysterious way, it's only by speaking out, verbally acknowledging our mistakes, failures, and anxieties to another person that the power of those feelings and deeds lose their control over us. Bill W. always said, step five is the hardest step of all because it makes us vulnerable and demands our humiliation before another person. I don't know how many of you in the room have done this. I know a number of you have because you've worked the steps yourself. I did. I was working the 12 steps in the context of my CODA group. I decided one day, my very first therapist, Dr. Waylon Ward, I decided I'd go to him and I'd confess. And I did that because of fear. You know, I didn't want it getting out. I knew I paid him to be confidential, that he couldn't tell my secrets to everybody. He'd lose his license for it, right? But it was the scariest and most liberating thing I've ever done in my life, to actually go through and make a comprehensive inventory of my life and to say, this is what I've done. This is what I failed to do. Here's all the things I've caused. Here's all the damage of my life. And to share it with him. And when I got done, to look in his eyes and see tears streaming down his face. And to know that the story I told was not an unfamiliar story. To know that in a sense, you know, his tears was saying, you know, welcome back into the family. In the book, The 12 Steps and 12 Traditions, the writers say, most of us declared that without a fearless admission of our defects to another human being, we could not stay sober. I'll tell you why this is so important, because the nature of addiction is to create great isolation and loneliness. A guy by the name of Tommy Rosen said, addiction is a disease of isolation. So when I get open, when I become vulnerable with others, I open myself up again to the human family. It's why Johann Harry said, the opposite of addiction is not sobriety, it's connection. Addiction has moved us away from the human family. Yes, sobriety is something we want and we need, but connection is the very thing that guarantees us sobriety. The Bible constantly encourages our need for one another. Look at these verses. Ecclesiastes 4, two are better than one. If one falls down, his friend can help him. But pity the man who falls and has no one to help him up. Or how about this? The second one, he who trusts in himself is a fool. You know, Brenda and I, this past summer, we went to San Francisco. I mean, we've heard so many of you go vacation there and go on and on about the city. I got to tell you, I was not impressed. All right, San Francisco itself, the city, I just felt like, man, this is really run down. I don't even feel safe in the city. But we went outside the city to the Muir Woods. And that was the highlight of the vacation for us. The Muir Woods are the redwoods, not far from the city of San Francisco. You know, redwood trees stand some 300 feet high. Some of them can be as large as 20 feet wide. They're the largest, tallest living organism on the planet. Some of them go back to the ancient Greek Empire 2,500 years ago. Now, in order for a tree to stand tall, we know it takes deep roots, right? And so, you know, you see these massive trees and standing so high, bigger than any tree you've ever seen in your life. And you think, man, these roots must go down a mile. You know what I discovered? Redwood roots go down about 5 or 6 feet. But they go 100 feet wide. They interconnect with one another. This is why you'll never find a single redwood tree standing all on its own. It's not possible. They connect to one another and they hold each other up through thousands of years of growth. It's a great metaphor for life, isn't it? I mean, yes, I want to send my roots deep into Christ, but I need to send my roots into my brothers and sisters as well. because nobody stands on their own. We all need each other. Again, Russell Brand is one of those polarizing characters. He's a guy people love or hate. I get that. As best I can tell, he really is trying to own his failures, especially in the area of alcohol, drugs, and sex. And he's written a lot about recovery. Here's a couple of quotes I just want to share. Change is hard. That's why we can't do it alone. And how about this? Without these fellowships, I would take drugs. Because even now, the condition persists. Drugs and alcohol are not my problem. Reality's my problem. Drugs and alcohol are my solution. So that leads to the next principle, which is give up. So in step number 6 of the program, it says, we were entirely ready to have God remove all these defects of character. Now, of all the steps we've looked at so far, you would think by the time you arrive here, this has to be the easiest step of all. But don't count on it. The truth is that a lot of people are not entirely ready to give up their character defects. Because, you know, to give them up would mean to take full responsibility for our life. It means to quit making excuses and to quit scapegoating on other people. It would mean to take full ownership of our life. And we cannot heal of the character defects to which we cling. I mean, I'll think about this. What does it take? What do you do? What's the first thing that you need to do to get a new car? People say, well, go to the dealership. And other people say, well, no, look on Craigslist. No, you're wrong. You got to give up on the old car. And if you give up on the old car, then you're ready to get a new car. And if you're really, really ready to get a new life, you got to give up on the old life that's not working. Step number 7, we humbly ask him to remove our shortcoming. Now, in step 7, it leads to a very important question. Can my higher power remove my shortcomings? This is one of the reasons I don't sweat the God issue in AA, because eventually every addict has to look long and hard at their higher power. You know, in the years that I've been involved in 12-step, I've heard a lot of people say different things. You know, the group is their higher power. A doorknob's their higher power. A bus is their higher power. I've heard a lot of things that some of them I think are silly. But if it gets them in the door and keeps them in the door, amen, hallelujah, I'm glad they're there. But you see, the designers of this program understood that the deeper you work into it, the more it puts your higher power to the test. Can your higher power deliver on these things? Friends, a doorknob can't take away your shortcomings. And the group is not going to be able to remove your resentments and unforgiveness. You need a God who's provided a remedy that can be trusted, that makes sense. And the founders of the program, they just understood this. You're going to have to understand, is my God capable of delivering on what I need? This is why it's so important for those who are believers to let their light shine. And I'm not just saying say the words, but to live the life. Because you know what? People are never argued into the kingdom of God. They're attracted. They're attracted because of what they see in a believer's life. They say what this person has is real and right, and I want what they have. And, you know, as they always say, you know, you are the only Bible some people are reading. It's true. People are looking at your life, and they're deciding whether or not your God is worthy of that worship. The fifth principle is straighten up. So if you think of step 6 and 7, they deal with our vertical relationships. Then versus steps 8 and 9, they deal with our horizontal relationship with God. So in step 8, it says, we made a list of all persons we'd harm and became willing to make amends to them all. Friends, the hurt that we have done to other people sticks to us like a toxic residue. This is why step 8 encourages us to make a list as comprehensive as memory permits, of spouses and former spouses, of lovers, employers, co-workers, creditors, of parents, children, friends, even enemies, people we've hurt psychologically, emotionally, spiritually, financially, sexually, physically, whatever way we've created harm. Think of it like this. Addiction is like a tornado that ripped through our network of family, friends, and acquaintances, and it left a huge debris field. Before you can rebuild, you got to clean up that debris field. You need to go through and make sure you're building on a strong, firm foundation, which leads to step 9. We made direct amends to such people whenever possible, except when to do so would injure them or others. To make amends, I'm not just saying I'm sorry for my wrongs. An apology is not an amends. The Bible calls this act restitution. This is a very biblical principle. We don't talk about it much in Christianity, but it's very true in Old and New Testament. In the Old Testament, if you defrauded somebody, If you took from somebody, if you caused an injury to somebody, there were laws about what you had to do to compensate that person for the injury or the harm done to their life. In the New Testament, remember there's this guy, his name's Zacchaeus, he's a tax collector, and he's very disreputable, dishonest, and he's ripped off people like crazy, and he comes to know Jesus, and as proof of the evidence of change of life, he says, Jesus, I'm going to go back and find all those people I ripped off, and I'm going to pay them back and then some. That's restitution. That's making an amends. It's a very biblical concept. So sometimes, though, an amends, the only amends I can make is to say I'm sorry and to make what we call a living amends, that I'm going to live differently from now on. Like, for example, let's say because you indulged your addiction so much, your spouse finally got sick and tired of it and they left you. They walked away. And they've remarried. Making an amends doesn't mean going back, getting them out of that marriage and remarrying them. That's not right. It's out of order. It doesn't honor God. That's not the way it happens. What you do is you sincerely apologize and you live as a different person, as a living amends. If maybe because of your addiction you neglected your kids, you harmed your kids in ways that you can't restore their lost childhood. It ain't happening. But you can live differently with your adult children and show them how much you love and care for them now. So making an amends, let me just say, is not contingent on the other person's response. You know, I know it takes two people to destroy a marriage. People don't always share equally in that blame, but it takes two people, two willing participants, to destroy a marriage. And maybe you go back and maybe that person still hates your guts. It doesn't matter what their response is. This is not about what you are owed. This is about what you owe, and you're cleaning your side of the street. You might recognize the name Anne McGraw. She was a famous actress from a bygone era, but she got into recovery, started owning her own alcoholism. This is what she said about making amends. Making amends is a powerful experience. It involves taking a cold, hard look at my behavior toward other people all these years, and then taking full responsibility for everything I've said and done. It is absolutely necessary in the great garbage cleaning process called recovery. You should know that in the big book, they say that all the promises of the program, all the things that you hope your life will become, they begin to materialize after you've taken this step. This is the promise. Look at this. We're going to know a new freedom and a new happiness. We will not regret the past nor wish to shut the door on it. We will comprehend the word serenity and we will know peace. That feeling of uselessness and self-pity will disappear. Self-seeking will slip away. Our whole attitude and outlook upon life will change. Fear of people and economic insecurity will leave us. We will intuitively know how to handle situations that used to baffle us. We will suddenly realize that God is doing for us what we could not do for ourselves. You want that to happen? It happens after you make amends. And then the final thing is to keep it up. So think of steps 10, 11, and 12 as kind of the maintenance principles of the program. Step 10 says, we continue to take personal inventory, and we were wrong when we were wrong, promptly admitted it. So step 10 is about staying current. Step 10 is saying, I'm not going to let this junk accumulate in my soul anymore. I had a professor in Bible college that always said, keep short accounts with God. Don't let it pile up. If there's something wrong, make it right. If you owe somebody apologies, set it in motion. Do it right away. If you need to make an amends to somebody for some way that you have harmed them, then make that amends. In other words, stay current so that you don't have this toxicity build up in your life that tends to drive the worst of behavior. Step 11 says, we sought through prayer and meditation to improve our conscious contact with God, praying only for knowledge of his will and the power to carry that out. Step 11 is the longest step, not just in terms of words, but also in terms of application. You will never finish step 11. You will work on step 11 for the rest of your life. Because this is when you realize now God is not a means to an end. He wasn't simply the way I got sober. God is the one I want to have a relationship with from now on. And therefore, through conscious contact, through prayer and meditation, I will maintain that relationship. The answer to addiction is a spiritual equation. It's about God. You know, it's interesting. More and more studies are finding today that only those programs that incorporate God, spirituality, have long-term success in helping addicts. So there's this, one of the first of its ever kind, the National Center for Addiction and Substance Abuse, which is called CASA for short, and Columbia University released a 52-page, two-year-long study, and it's called So Help Me God. And it's about the effect of spirituality in substance abuse programs. I want to just share a couple of quotes with you. Studies show that people with strong religious beliefs are healthier, heal faster, and live longer than those without them, regardless of their individual spiritual faith or spiritual practice. Isn't that amazing? That's hard data. That's not anecdotal. That's not based on a couple of conversations I've had. This is the evidence. Here's a second one. This is the professor at, he's a professor of psychology and psychiatry at the University of New Mexico. One of the most consistent findings in alcohol research, seldom mentioned in courses and textbooks, is that religious involvement significantly predicts lower current and future rates of substance abuse, problems, and dependency. Does that surprise you? No, because the answer to addiction is spiritual in nature. And one of my favorite quotes of all time, Philip Yancey, this is in an interview from 20 years ago. It staggers me that psychiatrists, pharmacologists, and scientific reductionists cannot improve on a spiritual program devised by a couple Christian alcoholics 60 years ago. Isn't that amazing? I mean, God just took Dr. Bob and Bill W. and did something really amazing in their hearts, and now it has literally transformed the lives of millions of people around the world. So the final step, having had a spiritual awakening as a result of these steps, we tried to carry the message to others with problems and to practice these principles in all of our affairs. In other words, if you really want to keep what you got to give it away. And that's one of the most paradoxical truths of the kingdom of God. If you want to keep what you have, you better be giving it away. And the more you give it away, the more you got, right? Because you can never outgive God. And this principle is about giving it away. It's about staying in conscious contact with others who are struggling to remind us not just where we came from, but that we're always one choice away from going back there. To stay in this place of sharing the good news. I want to wrap up with this quote. Again, one of my favorite quotes. It was an anonymous quote in that article by Philip Yancey about the church. When I'm late to church, people turn around and stare at me with frowns of disapproval. I get the clear message that I'm not as responsible as they are. When I'm late to AA, the meeting comes to a halt. Everyone jumps up to hug and welcome me. They realize that my lateness may be a sign that I almost didn't make it. When I show up, it proves that my desperate need for them won out over my desperate need for alcohol. I love that. And I've always thought that's what the church should be. Which is why we have so many latecomers in this church. No judgment. Your need for God won out for your needs for the Cowboys. And that's really great. I am so always glad you're here. I'm always glad when people come. And I don't really care what the hour or the minute they come in. I love that you're here. And I love that you care to seek God. So where does that leave us? Well, you know, for some of us, we got some challenges. You know, for some of us, we need to make an admission. Life as it is not working. You know, the one thing that's happened in every service since we started this series, people have come forward. I had people come forward last week and say, I'm 7 days sober from alcohol. I'm 3 days sober from heroin use. And people coming forward, which means they're making decisions in the context of this series, that they're saying, no more. These things that have been destroying my lives aren't going to destroy my life anymore. I had a confession right before the service started about a work crew. They were out away from the city, and one of the men on the work crew had a problem, and they were talking to him, said he really needed treatment. He didn't say, I don't need treatment. I won't go to treatment. And they listened to the first message in the series on the car back, the drive back to the Metroplex. And he said, okay, here's a treatment center I want you to take me to. And he owned it. You know, God is at work. And I'm telling you, we have folks that are in recovery and we have chaplains and they're hanging around after service and they're all going to kind of be up front. And if you feel like, you know, this is the kind of thing I'd like to talk to somebody about, pray with somebody about, please, by all means, just hang around and they will be happy to talk to you. Make a start. Take the first step. It's the first step in the spiritual life. It's the first step in the freedom from addiction to own our powerlessness, okay? Others of us in this room, you know, we think we have a big issue with God. And you don't have a big issue with God. You just don't know God. You don't know what he's really like. You got a lot of damage around your God image. You got a lot of bad thoughts and a lot of stuff that got loaded up on that, but you really don't understand this God who is relentless and passionate in his pursuit of you, who doesn't want to see your life over in a ditch, who wants to see you become everything that he meant for you to be. Some of us, we need to step out of isolation. Sure, we've prayed to God. We got our forgiveness. There's no question about that. But that isolation and that fear binds you still to your sin because you haven't been able to find a trusted Christian friend that you can share the real nitty-gritty of your life with. It may be the scariest thing you've ever done, but let me tell you, it is the most liberating. When we come back into the human family and we own that we're as broken as every other person, and so others of us, we're just hanging on to some stuff we don't need to hang on to. Somebody hurt you. And I understand it hurt really bad. It should have never happened. There's no justification for it whatsoever. Forgiveness is not about letting them off the hook. It's about letting you off the hook. Forgiveness is about releasing the emotional consequences of it. To say, I'm not going to have this poison my spirit. I'm not going to have this take me down. I'm not going to have it stop my progress in my life with God and relationships with others. I'm not going to be consumed by this anymore. I need to let it go. And some of you need to leave that go today. Would you pray with me? Father, I pray that as a church family, we would benefit from the wisdom of the 12 steps, from this wonderful knowledge passed down now for a couple of generations, the healing path for the addict, the healing path for the sinner. Everything that we read about, everything we've talked about is grounded in principle of Scripture. It's the path to freedom. It's the way we get set free. And for somebody who's here today who maybe for the first time is really ready to admit, you know, Lord, if I could do this on my own, I really would have done it long before now. And the truth is, I can't handle life on my own. I need other people. I can't stand on my own. I need to be connected. And so, God, I want to rejoin the human family. I want to step out of my isolation and out of my fear. I want to know what it's like to live in vulnerability and authenticity with others. God, for those that are here that, for whatever reason, there's been a lot of layers and baggage on their God image. And they see you as something that you're not. They fear you. They constantly sense a sense of disapproval. They feel like they get beat up every time they do wrong, and they just don't understand that they do that to themselves, that, Lord, you're the one who's come to rescue them, to bring them out of their sin, to bring them out of their brokenness, to redeem the curse. That's your role. And so, God, I pray that you begin to liberate their God image. For people who are harboring resentment, God, they would lay that at the altar today, to lay it down right now and say, God, I don't want to be controlled by this. I don't want this to dominate my thinking. I want these thoughts of revenge and people being hurt to go away forever because I want to release the emotional consequences of that right now and to say, God, heal my soul and heal my spirit. And I put this entire situation in your hands and trust, God, that your way is better than anything that I might ever dream or imagine. God, more than anything, help us to be your church. May we always be the kind of place that when people walk into this room, they sense this is a place where people really do love and know God. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you all.
Both ways.